Hello everyone, and welcome back to theCUBE's live coverage of VMware Explore. I'm your host, Rebecca Knight, sitting alongside John Furrier, my co-host and analyst. John, this is our last interview. It's been a great show.
It's a great show. Vijay is back. We're going to talk about cyber resilience, but ultimately what's happening is that with Gen AI and all the infrastructure advancements, the bar is high, and we had the Cyber Resilience Summit and theCUBE Studios, so in this world of VMware with VCF9 and all the action, this is a top priority.
Indeed,
cyber risk.
Best one, last one. So with that, I would like to welcome our next guest. He is Vijay Ramachandran.
Thank you.
Head of Product Management Core Infrastructure VCF Division at Broadcom. Thank you so much for coming on.
And thanks for having me back. The last Cyber Resilience Summit was awesome, and I'm looking forward to this discussion. You are my last stop.
And ours too.
Hey, we're all chilling out. It's the last for theCUBE too, but it's an awesome conversation. Can't wait.
So as you both have said, you were with us for the Cyber Resiliency Summit, so this is really a continuation of that conversation.
It is.
Why don't you level set with our viewers right now the difference between cyber threat management and cyber compliance?
Yeah, so there are two things, right? It's actually very simple in my mind. Cyber threat compliance is asking the question, what are the laws and how do we prove to the auditors and sometimes the customers that we are secure, right? And that's a key question that compliance is trying to answer. And we have to provide a set of tools as VMware for our customers to prove to their auditors that they are secure. Cyber security or cyber resilience is all about how do you do it? You know, what are the mechanisms and what are the tools to protect your data, and it's just not protecting your data, it's protecting workloads, things that are in flight, things that are in, data that's at rest. So the whole gamut of things, but the tools that we provide to protect them. So that's the difference. Right? It's a very, very simple kind of way to think about it. How do you prove and how do you protect?
Yeah? And someone might say, just encrypt everything. Well, it's not always possible. That's another opportunity.
It's not only not always possible, it's also the fact that a lot of times encryption in certain layers mean that the attack vector is going to be in some other layer. For example, we find that a lot of times the attackers are dormant for many, many months, sitting in memory. And when you run a VM or a workload, it's just sitting there and until it finds the right time to go and like encrypt events. So even if you do things like file scanning, which looks at data that's at rest, you cannot find it because it's not sitting there, it's sitting somewhere else.
Hiding in plain sight.
Exactly right, yeah.
So we know that so many organizations are struggling to manage compliance and keep up with managing cyber risk. From your vantage point, why is this so difficult?
Yeah, there are many aspects to this. It's actually becoming more and more complex. I'll give you an example. With Gen AI, it becomes even more complex. But I'll get to that in a second because I found something this morning that's very interesting. I'll tell you about it. There are three or four things that makes it complex. One is that data itself is spread in many places. Right, it's not stored in a single place. It's in your end devices. It's in the data center. It's in the cloud. How do you ensure that everything is protected against bad actors, both internally as well as externally, And that's not an easy thing to solve. The second is that a lot of customers deal with, an overdose of tooling. Right, if you go to a conference like this, a lot of the vendors here are cyber, have cyber security in some way, some form or the other, and so customers have various tools to do various things, and how do you orchestrate all these tooling to provide a holistic view? And that's not a simple task. And compliance, and there's another shift that's happening on compliance and proving this, that you're secure. It used to be a point-in-time audit. Auditors used to come, regulators used to come once a quarter, once a year. Now, customers are expecting a continuous compliance checks, right? And so we need to be able to provide a platform that does continuous compliance checks and remediation. And so these are the three factors. Things have changed. Things are a lot more spread out. Too many tools. And you need to be a lot more real time. It needs to be on a continuous basis. And I think that's the biggest challenge. Now I'll tell you the interesting story that I was going to tell you about. You know, before we used to have this thing called fat fingering. You know, fat fingering is, you know, you accidentally delete a file or whatever. With AI, there have been incidents where someone has typed something in AI that says, hey, optimize my environment, or optimize this, or clean up my environment. And the damn thing does, literally cleans up the whole thing, okay? And so, you know, customers have lost data, have lost workloads, because they entered the wrong prompt. And you're gonna see this happen a lot more, and especially with AI, bad actors can actually use that to wipe out an entire real estate of infrastructure. And so, at VMware, our goal is to provide tools and the capabilities to protect against not just the old way, the old threat vectors, but the new ones as well.
Vijay, Chris Wolf came on yesterday, was giving us a nice masterclass on private AI. It's a feature of VCF, not a separate thing, which is very cool to understand it that way. How is private AI fitting into this? Because it sounds like these are some of the things that are kind of are involved, because it's dealing with some of the AI challenges.
Yeah.
Is this related?
It's very much related. As I said, you know, one of the key aspects of private AI is that it's private.
Exactly. Yeah.
And so we have to and there are new devices, GPU and GPU memory, and the way the GPUs interact with each other. So the data needs to be protected not just when it's in memory and and when it's running in the GPU, but also when it crosses the host boundary and goes to another GPU in another host. So the type of protection that we need to provide to make it a true private AI is much more complex than what we had previously. And the other aspect, as I said, is that if something goes wrong, we have to ensure that we provide the entire environment, right? And so, it's a lot. Private AI makes compliance and security a lot more complex, but that's what makes it interesting for us to solve these problems.
Well, it solves some problems.
Yep.
So complexity comes, and then you guys simplify it.
Yep.
Let chaos reign in the
exactly
chaos,
right,
as Andy Grove
used
to say. All right, so I have to ask you about how you see the VCF piece, because if you look at VCF, it's bigger, it's like from a VMware customer standpoint, they say, okay, I got the private AI, I'm going to put out in the infrastructure, I'm essentially putting out a cloud.
It is.
So to secure that is complicated. How are you guys making it easier for customers? What should they know? What's, demystify some of the commentary that may not be accurate. We're hearing that it's very easy to manage from customers, not hard.
So our goal with VCF is really three things, right? Make it easy to operate, deploy and operate the whole private cloud. Make it secure and make it performant and at the lowest cost. Those are the three things. So those are the three pillars. And security for us is something that we don't, it's not a side conversation, it is part and parcel of the VCF.
First principle.
And if you look at the sort of the capabilities that we have, it starts all the way from, from the platform. You know, intrinsic security. This is the term that we use internally at VMware, within our organization. Intrinsic security means that in everything that we do, in the way we code, in the way we provide capabilities, it's secure. And just as an example, EDR, the endpoint detection recovery, is a technology that was used to protect endpoints, your laptops and your iPhones and so on and so forth. We are now bringing that kind of a technology into the hypervisor so we can protect the hypervisor, just as one example.
Yeah.
Confidential compute, as you know, has been around for a long time, and now we are making confidential compute, which provides protection, up to the memory level, for runtime environments. A critical part of our VCF capability, and so it's part of VCF, and we make it simple to enable.
That's a great point. Confidential computing, I mean, it's been around for a while, but it's kind of main street topic right now. It's prime time.
It is
more than ever.
It's more than ever.
Is it complete? Is it ready? Is it still evolving?
It is.
It's kind of like early now. It's like I'm in more conversations around confidential computing.
We are making it mainstream. We're making it mainstream by first of all ensuring that it's easy to use, right? Easy to enable. But more importantly, we want to ensure that all the features and all the vMotion and the all the great features, DRS and all the great features that we have work seamlessly with conferential compute. Now, one of the things that we didn't have previously was it worked, but not with all the features. And so we're making it work with all the features, so it's just part of the
I mean,
platform.
There's a lot of education, too. I bring this up because I've been in multiple conversations with CISOs about this in New York, specifically around financial services. They are encrypting their vector embeds, and they think they're secure. But actually not, because it's not got the confidential piece to it. I mean, that's a kind of a weird corner case, but it's one of these things where the old safety blanket of security, there's some areas to watch out for. Can you just share your thoughts on this? Because I know on the product side, we're seeing a lot focus on that piece. Not just the one example, but just generally. I think I'm good, but I'm not. I'm not,
So we hear this from customers all over the place, and in fact, our financial services sector and the defense sector across the world, this is what they keep telling us, is that, hey, look, we think we're secure because we have firewall, we are firewalling and we have network security, but somehow things escape and we get hit by ransomware or whatnot. So confidential computing is one such thing which protects you end to end, right? And just to give you one example, we're also integrating confidential compute which provides runtime protection, right? Not just like at-rest protection. With our tenancy model, right? So even a line of business, that has workloads can protect their own environment end to end without encroaching on someone else's data. So this is you're absolutely correct. Customers think that they're secure, but in many cases they're not. In fact, that brings me to my second point. If I can just finish my thought here. Even with all that. Okay, even with all the kinds of security, network security, platform security, confidential compute, runtime security, sometimes we still miss, things miss, and bad actors are always more are innovative, and and they find ways to get in. So to us, it doesn't end with just protection. Recovery is as important as protection, which means that in the worst case scenario where you're attacked and you have a ransom to give, many customers just give a ransom and but that's too expensive and it's disruptive. So what we want to do is we don't just want to protect, we want to provide recovery mechanisms as
And that, and cyber resilience actually is a recovery focused.
Yes,
because
exactly.
That's a benchmark now. Yeah. Time to recovery, rollbacks, all these things are around recovery for the situation, not just protect.
Previously, many customers used to think that backup was cyber secure or cyber resilient. Backup is not, right? So you need to be able to, when a customer does get attacked, you have to be able to create a clean room, a clean environment, be able to clean the data, and then recover the data in a timely fashion. And so, for us, we look at both aspects, protection for sure, but we acknowledge that even with the best protection mechanism, sometimes things, leak through, and we provide an easy button for recovery.
So I want to ask you, beyond VCF on the product side, when a customer deploys private cloud or enterprise cloud, as I call it, they also have their own cyber resilience practice. How do you guys intersect? What are they doing on their end? How is it tied together?
So that comes back to compliance, right? And customers have their best practices for, they have various standards that they need to follow. And
you don't disrupt that.
Sorry?
You don't disrupt their mechanisms.
Absolutely not, absolutely not. So we actually integrate with them, right? We actually work with them. And so when customers have, as an example, when customers have certain configuration rules that they need to follow, we provide the hooks to provide, to enforce those configuration mechanism on the private cloud in VCF, and we also provide mechanism to monitor it and detect drifts against that. And so we don't do something outside of what the standards the customers have prescribed, and so we work with it.
So we've really just talked today about how managing cyber risk has become exceedingly complicated and difficult. So looking ahead, how do you see cyber compliance shaping the broader AI and private cloud conversation?
Yeah, it needs to be, in my opinion, it needs to be intrinsic to the AI strategy. It cannot be a side note. It needs to be intrinsic to the AI strategy. AI is all about, you know, training, inference, and a lot of it involves data, right? In fact, AI is all about data. And so protecting the data and making sure that we can protect it and recover it, and all the NIST framework applies as well to the legacy workloads as it does to AI workloads. And so that's what we're doing at VNVCF.
Excellent. Well, Vijay, you were a terrific final guest, so thank you so much for coming. I know it's your last stop, our last stop too. Yeah. So
all
thank
right.
you so much.
Thank
I'm
so
Rebecca
much.
Knight for John Furrier. That wraps up theCUBE's live coverage of VMware Explore. Keep watching theCUBE. I'd like to thank our great crew. That includes Brendan and Tony and Andrew and Maverick and Leo. And also thank you to John Furrier. It had been a while since we worked together. It was really fun.
This was a great show. The product leadership was great. The results are good. Customers are happy.
Terrific
guests. Changing ecosystem, smart product. It's a product game now for VMware.
Indeed it is.
We'll see
Indeed
how it, goes.
It is. Well, keep
time.
Watching theCUBE for more. You're watching theCUBE, the leader in enterprise tech news and analysis.